Well, thank you, Olivia, for introducing me and for inviting me to deliver this series of lectures. I must confess that I feel a little bit uneasy about the fact of sharing my blackboard, well, which is a whiteboard, of sharing it with not less than 2 field medals. So, but my purpose will be very modest. Olivia asked me to give a basic introduction to Topos' theory, presenting the various aspects of this marvelous part of mathematics, but going as far as the classifying Topos' theory, which is no longer so elementary. So doing that in 6 hours, of course, forces me to focus on the basic notions, the basic techniques. I shall not have any time to develop the proofs, in particular the proofs of the very deep results. I shall mention some of them, but Laurent, Alain, and Olivia will take time to enter much deeper in the theory and the deep results. So I should start from scratch in order to introduce to Topos' theory those who came here to discover the topic. And I shall begin with something very simple. I consider the continuous functions from the reals to the reals, what we do in a first calculus course with our students. Okay, you know a lot of such functions. Well, certainly the identity, x squared, I don't know, sine x, the exponential, and so on. But probably you want to consider as continuous on the reals functions like 1 over x, tangent of x, the logarithm of x, and so on. Well, of course, these functions are continuous. Well, they are continuous where they are defined. And let me make very clear what the idea of being continuous means if we start to study Topos' theory. These are continuous on the reals. This means the following. For example, I have 1 over x, which is like this. If it is defined at some point, you have a full neighborhood of the point on which it is defined, and on that neighborhood, it is continuous. A full neighborhood of the points in the reals. This is completely different of the situation that you would have if you consider a function like square root of x, which is defined on the positive reals. Yes, it is defined and continuous on the positive reals, but I would not say that on the positive reals it's a continuous function on the reals, because at this point, you know, it is not defined on a neighborhood of the point. And when we want to develop Topos' theory to do things, everything should always occur on a full neighborhood of the point. So square root of x is continuous on the real, but only on the strictly positive reals, not on zero. On zero, it is continuous if you work on this very specific topological space, but I shall not consider it as continuous on the reals at zero. So that's the first idea when we look at continuous functions. So what I am doing, after all, because a subset of the reals, which is a neighborhood of each point, that's an open subset. So what I do is, whenever I have an open subset of the reals, I consider all the continuous functions defined on this open subset to the reals. Of course, if I have a smaller open subset, I have certainly a restriction mapping. A continuous function f can be mapped on its restriction at the level v, which is still continuous. That's very obvious. But there is more. If I have two open subsets, u and v, and two continuous functions, f and g, on the reals, look at the intersection. Suppose f and g coincide on the intersection. What do you have? Well, that means that you have a function f defined here, a function g defined there. On the intersection, they coincide, so you glue them together, and you extend this as a function defined on the union of the two subsets. Very obvious. If instead of taking two open subsets, I had taken 17 open subsets or an infinity of open subsets, as soon as the function agrees on all intersections, well, you glue them together and you get a very long continuous functions. That's exactly the idea of a sheaf on a topological space X. Here, X was the reals. So it consists of considering for every U open, you give yourself a set F of U. In my example, it was a set of continuous functions. If I have V open smaller than U, then you want to have a mapping from F of U to F of V, which, mimicking the situation here, we shall call the restriction, but this mapping can be whatever mapping. So, but when I have some element A here, I shall write it A restricted to V, but this restriction can be any mapping. You have a mapping from F of U to F of V when V is smaller than U. And then, of course, you see this fact. You will have the fact that if U is the join of the open subsets UI, if you have a union of things, and if you have elements at all the levels UI, but they are compatible. So when you restrict if I restrict AI and AJ, which are at two different levels on their intersection, I get the same thing. This is something compatible, which I shall say, then there exists a unique element A in the union, such that, well, this element is the gluing of what we had. Exactly the situation that we had here. If we take continuous functions at various levels, they coincide on the intersection, we are able to glue them on the union. That's exactly what we have. Notice that the mapping which is there should satisfy some reasonable compatibility. probably you want that if you have the element A at the level U, and you restrict the element A at the level U, so you do not change level, you do not change anything. An element of F of U restricted at this same level of F of U, it's itself. And that performing restrictions is compatible, so you just ask here to have a functor. You ask that F be a functor on the lattice of open subsets. So it is a functor from the lattice of open subsets of X to the category of sets. It's a functor, but with the gluing property. So that's the notion of a sheaf on a topological space. A morphism of sheaves is just a natural transformation between the functors. Let us view some examples. Well, certainly, we have, if we take two topological spaces, X and Y, well, we can define a sheaf on X just as in the very first example of the reals by saying every time I take an open subset, I take the continuous functions, well, to the topological space Y. Very obviously, this will produce an example of a sheaf just as in the case of the functions on the reals. But let us give another example. I shall still take this, and I shall take a continuous mapping from Y to X. Continuous. Well, this time I map U on the sections of P on U. So the set of S from U to I such that PS yields the identity on U. All the sections, I take the continuous sections, continuous, of course. The continuous sections S of P. Trivially, it's another example of a sheaf. This is the generic example of a sheaf. First important theorem in the theory of sheaves on a topological space, every sheaf is of that type. Let me explain why it is the case, well, give an idea of why it is the case. I have told you that the basic idea of a sheaf, the basic idea of topos theory, if something occurs, it occurs on the neighborhood of every point. So, if I am interested in the continuous functions at the neighborhood of a point, I take the example of the reals, just to be able to draw a picture. At the neighborhood of the point X, I am interested in studying all the continuous functions which can be defined on the neighborhood of X. But look at this function at the neighborhood of X. Here is another function at the neighborhood of X. they coincide on the neighborhood of x. So at the neighborhood of x, those two functions are equivalent as soon as the behavior of continuous function is concerned at the neighborhood of x. So what you are interested to do is, well, for every open subset containing x, you look at the continuous functions. Here I take on to the reals. But when two functions coincide on a small neighborhood, okay, that's the same behavior. So you take the colimit of all this. You take all the possibilities, but you identify when they coincide on a smaller neighborhood. So categorically, this means you take the colimit of all those things, and you get all the possible behaviors of a continuous function at the point x. It is what one calls the stalk of the sheaf of continuous functions at that point. So one can do the same thing if one starts with a sheaf on a topological space X. You consider, given X in X, you define the stalk of this sheaf at the point X as being the colimit of all the F of U for all U containing X. You look at all the possible behaviors of the elements of the sheaf at this point. And then you have here the space X. You have the point X. Above it, you put the stalk over X. If you have another element X prime, you will have here the stalk over X prime, and so on. This is why, for the time being, the union of all those stalks is a set, which I call Y, and I have an obvious projection, P, which is just the vertical projection. The whole stalk of X is mapped on X. Mm-hmm. Then, well, then you should provide Y with a topology. What is a topology? Well, every time you have an element in some F of U, you can define from U this U which is there. Every time you have an element X in U, you have the stalk over X. This is the colimit of the F of U. But A is an element in some of these F of U's. So it has an equivalent class in the colimit. The colimit is just the union, and you perform a quotient and so on. So A induces an element of the colimit, the equivalence class of A. So here you have the equivalence class of A in the stalk. So this provides a morphism which, with every element X of U, gives you an element of Y. Let me call this sigma X. Well, you provide Y with the final topology for all these sections. You put on Y the final topology for all these sections. And the point is that if you take an open subset U of X, well, no, let me say it more elegantly. The sheaf F is isomorphic to the sheaf of continuous sections of P. I have constructed a mapping from a Y to a X, so I have a sheaf of continuous sections. The sheaf of continuous sections is isomorphic to the sheaf I started with. That's the first big theorem that I mention without any proof. And the second one, which is closely related to this first one, is the following. Say that a map P from Y to X is étal. In all languages one uses the French word, is étal. That means that for every element Y in Y, there exists open neighborhoods, let me say, U of Y and V of P of Y, such that from U to V, P becomes an homeomorphism. So a map is étal if locally, if at the neighborhood of each point, it's an homeomorphism. Well, first basic examples, you take two copies of X and you project them on one copy of X. So Y is two copies of X. Well, of course, for every point here, you have an open neighborhood which is isomorphic to that open neighborhood. That's the very first trivial example. Another less trivial example, take the helix and project it on the circle. Every time you take a point of the helix, there is a neighborhood of this point which is homeomorphic to a neighborhood of its image. So these are the étal mappings. And the second deep theorem that I want to mention is that the category of étal mappings over X, so the objects are the étal mappings over X, the morphisms are the étal mappings which make the triangle commutative. You take the category of étal mappings over X, it is exactly equivalent to the category of sheaves over X. I have given you the equivalence. If you start from a sheaf, well, you perform this construction and you get an étal mapping. The P which is constructed is an étal mapping. Conversely, if you start from an étal mapping, you take the sheaf of continuous functions. So these are the two first big theorems about sheaves over a topological space. Now, with that notion of étal mapping in mind, let me give you a further example of a sheaf in order to show you how one uses sheaves in order to prove theorems. I shall work with a ring. So, to make my life easy this afternoon, a ring is commutative with a unit. Let's take the easy situation, a ring commutative with a unit. You know what an ideal of a ring is, and you know what a prime ideal of a ring is. The prime ideal of a ring, that's an ideal such that if the product of two elements is in the ideal, one of them is already there. Like for the natural number, well, this has the multiple of a prime number. If a product is divisible by the prime number p, well, certainly p is a factor of r or is a factor of s. So these are the prime ideals of a ring. And probably you remember from your algebra courses that a ring always has enough prime ideals. You prove that using Zorn's lemma and the axiom of choice and so on. So there are always enough prime ideals to separate elements and ideals and so on. Fine. A ring has enough prime ideals. So I define the spectrum of the ring as a set of prime ideals of the ring. Classical definition. The spectrum of a ring is a set of its prime ideals. Now, one makes this a topological space. How do you make this a topological space? Well, every time you take an element of the ring, you consider O index this element, or maybe I should write a capital O probably, the set of the prime ideals such that this element doesn't belong to the prime ideal. A product doesn't belong to the prime ideal if and only if none of them belongs to the prime ideal. So this means that ORS is OR intersection OS. If R is not in the prime ideal and S is not in the prime ideal, RS is not in the prime ideal because the ideal is prime, that's the definition. So when I take these subsets as open subsets, I get at once a family of open subsets which is stable under finite intersections. So I have already a base of the topology. If I want a topology, I only need to take the unions of those things. But of course, every point, when I consider a neighborhood of a point, it will have an open neighborhood, and this open neighborhood will contain a basic open neighborhood. So these are sufficient for working with the open neighborhoods of the points. But okay, if you formally want the topology, you have to take the unions of such basic open subsets. Mm-hmm. Then, above P, I shall put a stalk. I shall construct here a space. Well, I had always written y, so let me keep the notation y. So for every point here, I want to define the stalk. What is the stalk? Well, it is just the local ring corresponding to the prime ideal. If you have a prime ideal, you can look at all the formal expressions R on S such that S doesn't belong to P. You take the formal ring of fractions of elements, but the denominator should not be in the prime ideal P. Well, that's trivially a ring with the usual rules for adding and multiplying fractions. But it is a local ring. What does it mean that it is a local ring? This means that R over S is invertible, or 1 minus R over S is invertible. Well, certainly if R is not in P, that's okay. If R is not in P, the inverse is S over R, which exists. Now, what about but if R is in P? Well, look, 1 minus R over S, that's S minus R over S. And this one cannot be in P. Would it be in P in the case where R is already in P? Then S would be in P, and S is not in P. So you have a local ring, every element is invertible, or 1 minus this element is invertible. A local ring has a lot of nice properties. Okay, so we have constructed here Stokes every time by inverting the elements not in the prime ideal. Then again, you put a topology by considering the section. Sections like that. So if you have a section, if you take the element O, the open subset OS, you can go to the stalk. So the element P goes on the fraction R over S, that's the sigma RS. For every element P, S is not there, so you take R over S in the stalk over P. So for every P, you go and pick up R over S in the stalk. And again, you put the final topology for that, and you prove that you have an ethyl mapping. This is not obvious. You have an ethyl mapping, and the point is, very important theorem in ring theory, the ring R is just isomorphic to the ring of sections, of continuous sections, of course, of Y to the spectrum. So if you take the global section, the continuous section of the whole spectrum, you recapture exactly the ring you started with. Now, when you have such a continuous section, at each point, it ends up in a local ring. So at each point, its value is invertible, or 1 minus the value is invertible. But you have much more. For every P, well, for every section, for every such section, let me call it sigma, for every P in the spectrum, there exists a neighborhood U of P such that everywhere on U, sigma is invertible or 1 minus sigma is invertible. So you get the fact that you have been able to describe the ring R. But if you view this ring, you have shown that it is a ring isomorphic to a ring of continuous functions. And these continuous functions on a neighborhood of each point, or they are everywhere invertible, or 1 minus the function is everywhere invertible. And so if you want to prove results on the ring R, but work instead with the ring of continuous functions, you can use the full power of the theory of local rings. This is one of the reasons why sheaves can be quite useful, including to prove theorems about things which have nothing to do a priori with sheaves, like to study a ring. Okay. Now I would like to switch to some properties of the sheaves on a space, and let me at once generalize a little bit the notion. We have seen that a sheaf is a functor with good gluing properties on the lattice of open subsets. Why not replacing this by an arbitrary lattice? Oh, yes, but if I want to write down the gluing condition, if I have an element which is a join of, so joins should exist. So probably I should work on a complete lattice and repeat exactly the definition on this complete lattice instead of the lattice of open subsets. It's a good idea, but it will not work. It will not work for the following reason. If you have the UI which cover U, so the union of the UI is U, you have V. If you restrict, if you take the V intersection UI, they will still cover V, because V intersection, the join of the UI, that's the join of V intersection the UI. You have this distributivity which works between intersection and union of open subsets. So this should be required from L. So you want U intersection a join of elements, that's a join of U intersection the UI. This distributivity, which will tell us that if this UI covers something, when I restrict, I still get a covering. Such a complete lattice with this distributivity law is called a locale. And of course, the whole theory of sheaves on a space can be developed exactly in the same way sheaves on a locale. So the sheaf will be a contravariant functor. If V is smaller than U, then you have the restriction which goes the other way. And if you take AI in F of UI, if AI restricted to the intersection is AJ restricted to the intersection, and if you call U the join of the UI, then there exists a unique A in F of U, such that for every I, A at the level UI is AI. I repeat exactly the definition of a sheaf on the topological space, but now the U are no longer open subsets, they are elements of my lattice L. And to exhibit some interesting properties of the category of sheaves on a locale, the category of sheaves on a locale is called a localic topos. I should at least introduce the word topos once in my lecture. The sheaves on a locale constitute what is called a localic topos. The sheaves on the space are an example of a localic topos. But let us look at a very trivial example of a sheaf. I take U, an element of my locale, and I take the functor represented by U. That is, V goes on the morphisms from V to U. But a lattice, the only morphisms are the inclusion. There is a morphism when V is smaller than U, and there is no morphism at all when V is not smaller than U. So this is the singleton if V is smaller than U, and the empty set if V is not smaller than U. Obviously, this is a sheaf. The gluing condition, there is no problem of gluing. If all the VI, if you have something to glue, that's because all the VI are smaller than U, and then the join of the VI is smaller than U. And there is a unique element at each level. So there is no problem at all in checking that this is a sheaf. But there is another sheaf, well, somehow related to that one. Let me write it omega. It maps U on the don't segment of U, so the set of V which are smaller than U. Well, that's trivially a sheaf, because once more, if I take various UI and some VI smaller than the UI, well, then the join of the VI is smaller than the join of the UI, and here I have the gluing. If I take some VI at various level UI, how do I glue those VI together? Well, just I take their join. So this is trivially another example of a sheaf. Fine. Let's go further about locales. Take a locale I claim that if U are in a locale, There is something like that. Oh, that's very easy to decide what the question mark should be. The question mark should be the join of all the elements V such that U meet V is less than W. U meet V is less than W if and only if U is smaller than this join. Fine. I shall write this element V implies W. Why not? Why not? Sorry. U meet V. So I defined V implies W as a join of all the elements such that the intersection with V is smaller than W. And then I have U meet V is less than W if and only if U is less than V implies W. Fine, but that's a result, this exists. But why did I use that notation? Well, think a moment that the elements of our locale are mathematical statements. I have a lattice of mathematical statements. From the statement U and the statement V, I can infer the statement W if and only if, from the statement U, I can infer that the statement V implies the statement W. If you think the elements of the locale as statements, this is the notation you want to write down. If from U and V I can infer W, that means that from U I can infer that V implies W. So, that's another property of a locale. And I shall now conclude with properties of the localic topos, so of the sheaves on the locale. Well, first of all, the topos of sheaves on the locale is certainly a complete category. The limits are simply computed pointwise. You just take a family of sheaves, you want to compute its limit, compute the limit as ordinary functors, you observe it is a sheaf. That's just a routine, it's very obvious. The second important property, this is Cartesian closed. That means that if I have three sheaves, I have this. If I have three sheaves F, G, and H, there exists a sheaf H power G such that the mapping from the product are the same as the mapping from F to this power. That's the definition of a Cartesian closed category. The product has a right adjoint. Why is that the case? Well, it's fairly easy to see what H power G should be. Just take F to be the functor represented by U. Zen, H, power G, is a functor, so it's what is its value on the point U of the locale. By the Yoneda lemma, it is a set of natural transformation from the representable functor to this. That's the Yoneda lemma. But you want to have this property. So you have no choice. You must define this to be the set of natural transformation there. You have no choice because you want to have this. So the only possible choice to expect that the result will be true is that one, by the Yoneda lemma. You must have this, and if you want to have your result, you must choose this as a definition. And once you have written down this formula, it's again pure routine, very easy routine, to check that it works. And the very last property of the topos of sheaves on the locale that I want to emphasize is the following one. I remind you that we have found a sheaf. Omega of U is the down segment of U, all the things smaller than U. In the category of sets, the category of sets is of course a topos. Sets is the topos of sheaves on the singleton. If you take S space, topological space, the singleton, a sheaf on the singleton, well, it's just giving a set. Okay, so in the topos of set, if you have a subobject of A, of a set A, you have the two-point sets false and true. You have the singleton true. You have a characteristic mapping phi of S. A is mapped on true if A is in S, and on false if A is not in S. That's the reason why I call the two elements of the set the two words true and false. And of course, here you have the unique mapping to the singleton. You have just defined a pullback. The elements of S are exactly those which are mapped on true. This is saying that this is a pullback. So every subobject has a characteristic mapping. The same holds in the case of sheaves on a locale. You have omega, and you have one, the constant functor on the singleton, which trivially is a sheaf. The constant functor, which is one at all level. Okay, so I shall have a mapping here, which I call the truth mapping. So of one of you, omega of U. I have to explain what it is. Well, but one of U is just a singleton. Omega of U is a down segment of U, and I map the singleton on U itself, on the top element. So that the truth mapping at each level, it maps the unique element of the singleton on the biggest element of the down segment on U itself. If I have a subsheaf here, and if I have an element in A of U, I can ask the question Dus E belong to S. If the question is, does A belong to S of U, the answer is yes, or it is no. It is in S of U, or it is not. But when I say, does A belong to the subobject, think a little bit. A is the sheaf of continuous mapping on the reals. And here I have the subsheaf of differentiable functions on the reals. I ask the question, is the continuous function absolute value differentiable? Answer, no. Absolute value is not differentiable. Is it not more sensible to say absolute value is differentiable everywhere except at zero? It's much more precise answer than saying no, absolute value is not differentiable. So we define phi like that, and it maps A on the biggest element V, such that at this level we are in S. When I have an element, I do not say yes it is or no it is not. I say let me look at the biggest level where it lives in S. This is my truth value of A belongs to S. That's the biggest level where this is the case. And then I get a pullback. So I have a subobject classifier. Every subobject is obtained. Well, this is definitely a monomorphism since I go from the singleton. So every subobject is a pullback of this generic monomorphism. Every subobject has a characteristic mapping. There is a subobject classifier. Okay, I shall stop some minutes. So as far as I know, you did put...
No,
but let us stop 5 minutes maybe. But I wanted to say, I have written notes, you see, I have a lot of notes here, 60 pages of notes. They will occur at some point on the site of the conference.
Today, they should be available from the program section of the website, of the conference website.
Okay.